Welcome back, guys. It's actually been a little while since I made a video because I've been working and I'm actually in the middle of a move. But I think it's important to just get this video done because of the urgency with all the COVID-19 outbreak that's going on in the United States and the rest of the world. So in this video, I actually want to talk about the impact of vitamin D and vitamin C, and also the weather, cold weather versus warm weather, and humidity levels, and how that affects the common cold, how that affects COVID-19, and how that affects the influenza virus. So let's go ahead and get started. So first things first, does colder temperatures make you more prone to getting the common cold, to getting influenza, to getting COVID-19, which is caused by the SARS coronavirus type 2? Most health experts agree that when it's colder out, more people end up spending more time indoors, and this actually facilitates the spread of viruses. Also, experts believe that when it's warmer weather, the immune system might actually function a little bit better compared to colder weather. And there are actually studies out there that looked at specific viruses and how they spread during cold versus warm weather and at different humidity levels. Back in 2007, there was this study. In this one particular study looking at the spread of the influenza virus, they put guinea pigs together in a chamber and carried out different environmental experiments on them. They found that low relative humidities of 20 to 35% were most favorable for infection, while transmission was completely blocked at high humidity levels of 80%. They also found that when guinea pigs were kept at 5 degrees Celsius, transmission occurred with greater frequency compared to 20 degrees Celsius. And at 30 degrees Celsius, there is no transmission detected at all. The authors concluded that low relative humidities produced by indoor heating and cold temperatures favored spread of the influenza viruses. I also want to add that during the winter months, during the cold weather, people can get runny noses without actually having a cold. But if they have a cold and they have this runny nose, those viruses can be spread easier in those secretions that come from the nose. And then people often wipe their nose without cleaning them and then shaking other people or touching surfaces, and then other people touch those surfaces. So that's another factor into why viruses spread better in the winter months. 40% of common colds are caused by rhinoviruses. The second most common cause of cold is the coronavirus, the normal coronavirus, not this novel coronavirus, aka SARS coronavirus 2. It's been shown that the rhinovirus reproduces more quickly at colder temperatures, which means you can catch a cold more quickly if you're cold. And this probably applies to the coronavirus as well. It's likely that with a combination of all these five factors that I just mentioned, meaning colder temperatures, lower humidity, people staying indoors more often in the winter months, cold weather causing runny noses, and our immune system being more active when it's warmer, these combination of factors likely explains why colds, flu, and COVID-19 are more likely to cause infections in the winter months. But there's likely a sixth factor as well, and that's vitamin D. Our bodies don't normally make vitamin D unless we get sunlight. In the winter months, for most of us in the world, we don't get enough sunlight to make enough vitamin D, unless you live in a warmer climate, then maybe you are an exception. So if you aren't getting enough sunlight in the winter months, that means you have to get enough vitamin D in your diet. And if you don't do that, you'll have low vitamin D levels. Vitamin D helps regulate our calcium levels and is important for bone and muscle health. It also plays a role in regulating our immune system, but its exact role is not known. So why is this important when it comes to the common cold and the flu and possibly even COVID-19? So vitamin D doesn't actually affect viruses. It actually affects the way our immune system handles infections such as viruses. Back in 2017, there was a large study in the British Medical Journal, and it was a meta-analysis, meaning it looked at a bunch of other studies, combines all the data from each of those studies, and analyzes and interprets these numbers into one huge study. In this meta-analysis specifically, it looked at over 25 randomized controlled trials with a total of over 11,000 people who took vitamin D. In this meta-analysis, it showed that there was a significant association between low vitamin D levels and being more prone to developing respiratory infections. It also showed that daily or weekly supplementation with vitamin D had the greatest benefit for those with vitamin D deficiency. The ones who benefited the most were the ones with more severe vitamin D deficiency, specifically blood levels below 10 ng per ml. and this decreased their risk of respiratory infection by 50% if they had vitamin D supplementation. It also showed that all participants experienced some beneficial effects from regular vitamin D supplementation, not just if they were deficient. It also showed that taking occasional high doses of vitamin D did not produce significant benefits. So the key takeaway there is that you have to take the vitamin D on a relatively routine basis for it to be effective. And these results were statistically significant with a large N of over 11,000. So what is my recommendation for taking vitamin D? The best thing that you could do is actually have your doctor check your vitamin D levels. If low, you could get vitamin D supplementation. Maybe this is done by getting more in your diet. Maybe this is done by taking a vitamin D supplement. Exactly how much you take should be a discussion between you and your doctor. I do realize that not everyone from a practical standpoint can get their vitamin D levels checked. A good broad recommendation would be to take 800 IU or 1000 IUs either every day or every other day. And it's highly unlikely that someone taking that dose every day is gonna run into vitamin D toxicity. But again, that's a broad generalization, so we can get into a little bit more details with that right now. If you're getting your vitamin D levels measured, you wanna aim for a level between 20 to 30 NGs per ml, and definitely do not exceed 39 NG per ml. We also know that too much vitamin D can be a bad thing. Vitamin D is one of four fat-soluble vitamins, and that means the body stores the vitamin more readily in the body compared to non-fat-soluble vitamins. And this is significant because storing it in the body means more potential for it to have toxic effects. So just remember, too much is not a good thing. With vitamin D, as well as other supplements, some brands are more trustworthy than others. My go-to source to find out trustworthy brands for vitamins and supplements and such is consumerlab.com. And this is an independent lab that tests various products. I have no association with them and there's no financial relationship that I have with them. So you can check out that website. The vitamin D that I personally recommend, I have no relationship with this company either, would be Nature Made. This Nature Made brand for vitamin D is also recommended by Consumer Lab. If you want to purchase it on Amazon, I'll provide a link below. Vitamin C is a water-soluble vitamin that is important for our overall immune health. Its exact role is not known, however. It does seem to help the function of white blood cells. But again, the exact role in our body's defenses is unknown. Vitamin C is also important for iron absorption, and being deficient in iron can make you more vulnerable to infections in general. The normal recommended daily intake of vitamin C for adults from the diet and or from supplements is 75 to 120 milligrams. You can get about 80 to 90 milligrams from a cup of orange juice or a sliced orange, or even more from a kiwi fruit or a couple of sweet peppers. So it's pretty easy to get adequate amounts of vitamin C just from the diet alone. It's common folklore that taking vitamin C supplements helps treat cold symptoms. But for the most part, that folklore just doesn't hold up to scientific study. In 2005, researchers analyzed 55 published studies that looked at vitamin C's ability to fight symptoms of the common cold, and the findings were pretty underwhelming. In most of the studies, they found no benefit to taking vitamin C to treat a cold, though one large study found that people taking a very large dose, 8,000 milligrams, at the start of a cold got better faster. But subsequent studies were not able to confirm these findings. As of now, there's not enough research to recommend that people take vitamin C supplements either before or after they get a cold. So once again, there's no evidence that taking a vitamin C supplement, even at high doses, can protect people from infection from coronaviruses. This strategy is being promoted on various websites and social media. High doses of vitamin C given intravenously are currently being looked at in COVID-19 patients in China who developed pneumonia. So those results are still pending. But taking in more vitamin C than you need can lead to some side effects. That includes GI upset, so stomach upset, maybe a little diarrhea here and there. And if you take too much over the long term, that can lead to kidney stones and possibly cataracts. So until there are further studies that definitively show that vitamin C supplementation is beneficial in preventing and or treating respiratory illnesses, such as the common cold, flu, and now COVID-19, I do not recommend taking extra vitamin C unless you are vitamin C deficient. And it's highly unlikely that you're vitamin C deficient if you eat food on a daily basis. Zinc has been one of the most popular suggestions for helping with symptoms of cold and even this COVID-19. There have been conflicting results about the effect of zinc on the severity and duration of cold symptoms. Some studies showed that zinc reduces the duration of a cold by half, while others showed no effect. Another study found that the type of zinc taken determined the result. Zinc gluconate lozenges that provide 13 milligrams of zinc lessened the duration of colds, but zinc acetate lozenges that provided 5 or 11 milligrams of zinc did not. Zinc has also been shown in a lab study to inhibit the replication of coronavirus in cells, not this novel coronavirus, but the regular coronavirus. There's no evidence at this time, though, to suggest that using zinc lozenges can prevent this novel coronavirus, this COVID-19, and additional research is needed to determine whether zinc actually has an effect on colds. Also, keep in mind that excessive zinc ingestion can lead to copper deficiency and can impair the absorption of antibiotics, and the use of zinc nasal gels or swabs has been linked to temporary or permanent loss of smell. Traditionally, echinacea has been used to help treat cold symptoms. There have been multiple studies that have suggested that taking it when cold symptoms first begin reduces the length and severity of symptoms. However, these studies were very low quality, and higher quality studies that have been done since then showed that there was no benefit to doing so. Okay, now a final word regarding herbs and supplements. It's difficult to talk about most herbs and supplements with scientific authority because most have not been well studied for effectiveness, for side effects, and for appropriate dosage. Also, the FDA does not strictly regulate how herbs and supplements are manufactured. Therefore, compared to prescribed medications and non-prescribed medications, there's a bigger unknown in terms of strength, purity, and safety. So it's best to talk to your doctor before you start taking any supplement. Many interact with medications and many interact with each other, and some are not recommended for people with certain health conditions. Most supplements should be avoided by women who are pregnant or breastfeeding, and most haven't been tested for safety in children and therefore should not be given to them. Now, I'm not trying to hawk any products like this guy.
You're saying that silver solution would be effective.
But what I am trying to do is build this channel to get up-to-date and accurate health information to you. So if you found this video useful, give it a like, and you can see me in the next one, especially if you subscribe and click on that bell button.